Hi, everybody. I'm Charlie Parker. I'm a grateful recovered alcoholic. By the grace of God and the fellowship of Alcoholics Anonymous and an honest attempt to work the steps of this program and good sponsorship and a lot of newcomers, I haven't found it necessary to take any mind or mood-altering chemical or drink any alcohol since March 22nd of 1985, and for that I am truly grateful. We were just in Seattle, we were in Vancouver, Canada last week, and boy, do I have a story about that. But the guy said, well, around here people don't really give their sobriety date, you know. He said that some people look at it kind of like you're bragging if you give your sobriety date. And I said, well, that's funny. In Texas, they say if a guy doesn't give his sobriety date, he may not have one. Yeah, how to win friends and influence people. I want to thank the committee for having us up here. I don't want to forget anybody. Chuck and Jeff and everybody that was on the committee that had anything to do with getting us here. The people, that lovely gift basket we had in our room, they're just taking really good care of us. And you know, I've been around AA long enough to know that in an event of this size, there's a lot of people that do a lot of work to put something like this together. I also know, if it's the fellowship that I crave, that there's a lot of people that didn't do a damn thing. But we have a lot of ideas about how it could have been done just a little bit better. You know what I mean? So, nice job. So, for those, we have room on the committee for next year, you know. I want to thank, first of all, Barbara and Chris did a fine job of reading the work there, and I want to thank Rod for picking us up at the airport and taking good care of us. Rod's a super guy. He's not married, but he is conducting interviews. If anybody, this is Rod right here. We really like him, and I'm sure you will too. He's really just been a gracious guy, you know, and that bond. It's funny because when we were talking about coming up here, he said, "How will I know you?" And I described myself, and you know, I'm hard to miss, but I can't tell you how many times we've been flying somewhere and they'll have somebody there to meet you and you come off the elevator and, you know, drunks, no drunks on an energy level, you know. I mean, and you come down and you go, oh, that's our guy right there. You know, I mean, there's no question about it, you know. And it's just like with Barbara. Katie and I, we had lunch and Barbara was at where she works in Bentonville. And Katie and I both said, oh, we could hang out with her, you know. I mean, now, unfortunately, that generally means you're a really sick alcoholic, you know, that desperately needs this program. But if I'm drawn to you, that's not a good sign, you know. You know, I want to thank, we've got our friend Bob is here. And how many of y'all went to any of the Big Book Workshop today? You know, Bob will be speaking tomorrow night, and it's me telling you that he's going to give a good talk. It reminds me of the temple that was getting a new rabbi, and the rabbi was getting ready to leave, and he says, "Now I know it's going to be disturbing for me to be leaving, but," he says, "the next guy is going to be really good." And the guy in the audience yelled out, "That's what they said when you were coming." You know, but We're glad, you know, it was a little disturbing. I went to about 3 hours of Bob's Big Books. We just had Bob down to Austin. We've had him to Austin the last 2 years from the for the Big Book Experience, and I highly recommend those. But I don't recommend going to him right before you're going to talk, because I was feeling pretty good yesterday and this morning. And then I got up here and listened to Bob for about 3 hours, and I was sitting there going, "Katie, I got nothing." You know, I mean. I'm glad to be here. My home group is the primary purpose group of Alcoholics Anonymous in Austin, Texas. We meet on Tuesday nights at 7:30, And we'd love for you to come by. We study the big book line by line, word by word, and I know that that is popular up here in Arkansas. It's not going on everywhere, but there are pockets of enthusiasm of big book folks around, but some of my heroes come from right here in Arkansas, and I'm always, I love the big book. I love the results of the work brought about by the big book, and all this is a leather-bound copy of a large print version of the big book that a friend of mine gave me. It's probably my most prized possession. And this book makes a lot of promises to me. It doesn't wait long to do it. Right here on the title page, it says the story of how many thousands of men and women have recovered from alcoholism. I used to think it was arrogant as heck to say I was a recovered alcoholic. There was a guy that Jim and I used to see at the Kerrville Folk Festival said he was a recovered alcoholic, and I thought, that's really cocky, you know. And then one day somebody said, no, it just means that we've recovered from a hopeless condition of mind and body. And the book says recovered about 17 times in the course of the book. And I went, oh, never mind. You know, I mean, but, so amends to Chuck from Kerrville Folk Festival if I ever run into him. My original sponsor is here from Arkansas. Jim Fletcher's here tonight, and he's been my sponsor since I met him in a treatment center in 1984. And he's a great example of what, you know, the care and the love that one alcoholic can have for another one. And I want to publicly thank you, Jim. My current sponsor, Jim, moved to Arkadelphia, Arkansas. Is that really a place? Is that? I mean, Jim moved to Arkadelphia about 7 years ago, I guess, and my current sponsor is Mark H. There in Austin, and I've been very fortunate to have some good sponsorship over the years. You know, I wear a suit when I get up behind the podium, right? Because my sponsor tells me to, for one thing, and the other is out of respect for Alcoholics Anonymous, but I got to tell you, the bulk of my experience in a coat and tie, my job was to say, no contest, Your Honor. You know, I mean, okay, y'all, before we get into the talk, I got to tell you what happened last weekend. Katie is the love of my life and my best friend, and we are, and she's right down here in the front. I'll stand up, Katie, right there. And Katie gives a whale of a talk, and she's got 5 months more sobriety than me, and she'll never let me live it down, you know, and I've kept her sober a few times by telling her that if she drinks again, I'll sponsor her when she comes back. But I'm going to try to tell this story the fastest way possible. But Katie was speaking in Vancouver, Canada last weekend, last Saturday night. She was the Saturday night speaker at the North Shore Roundup. It's the largest AA conference in Canada. And there was well over 2,000 people in the room. Well, we didn't know that. We were just going up to this conference in Canada. I go get my passport out. It's in the gun closet, you know, and I walk in there and I just take it. And it's in a fancy leather case because I'm, you know, hot stuff. And I walk in there and I check it, and it says expires 2013. I'm good to go. Katie's has expired. She orders a new passport. They send, instead of a passport, she checked the wrong box online, they sent a little card, you know, and these cards are for people that live close to the border. I'm trying to tell this really fast because I don't want to eat into my AA time. She goes to the passport office, and the little kid, his name was Cullen, if you want to get an idea how old he is. I mean, is there anybody over the age of 30 named Cullen? You know, I mean, well, anyway, Cullen says, everything will be fine. You know, don't worry. He goes, I think it'll be fine. And Katie, if you know Katie, her nickname is Scrappy. So she says, Cullen, I think is not going to be an acceptable answer. You know, so he goes back, he says, no, absolutely, you're fine till the 1st of June, birth certificate, driver's license, you're good to go. Well, so we get to the airport, and we're going to fly to Vancouver, and we get to the airport, and they said, no way. That says it's for land and sea travel. You cannot board the plane if you don't have a passport. That's the way our day started off. She's out on the curb. She's crying, you know, and she's, I'm not going. And, well, my job is to make sure that Katie doesn't get upset about anything, because then when she's happy, I'm happy. Is it? If that's codependent, I'm sorry. But I said, let me go and try to work some magic, honey. And I go inside, and they said, well, no, it's only good for land travel. And I said, well, then can you fly us to Seattle? Because they said it was about an hour drive. Anybody familiar with that 3-hour marathon death march? So they change our tickets. We fly to Seattle. This is where it gets good. We get in a rental car, and we drive up to the border, and we get to the border. You know, it's 4:15. We're going to make it fine. We're having a good time. We get up there, and I hand my little fancy passport case to the lady. She opens it up. She pulls the passport out of it, and she goes, what? You're handing me a Korean passport with your photograph pasted in it? And I went, what? It was like an out-of-body experience. She might as well have pulled a pound of heroin out of my briefcase. I mean, because let me tell you, folks, they were not playing. She holds up a passport with my picture in it and Korean handwriting on the back. Writing on the back of it. And then we're both going, what? And she slams the window shut. They SWAT around us. They pull over there, mister, and they get inside, and the guy's going, I need an explanation of why do you have a Korean passport? And I said, buddy, I got nothing. He's like, I need a better story than that. He goes, your story is weak. And I go, it damn sure is. You know, I got no story. And they're barking, one guy to ask you a question, you start to answer, barking another question over here, barking. I'm like, guy, I don't know if I'm supposed to be talking or listening. I mean, you guys are scaring the crap out of me. And they are serious, man. And let me tell you something else. The Canadian customs people do not like to be called dude. I know that now. At one point I go, dude, I feel like I'm on Punk'd. I'm waiting for Ashton Kutcher to pop up out of the, from behind the counter, and he goes, well, let me assure you, you are not on a game show. And I'm like, so 3 hours in the passport department, and these guys were not playing. They never, there wasn't any shucking and jiving. There wasn't, and of course, Scrappy, at one point, they're barking at her, and she goes, I'm done. You're not going to talk to me like that. And she goes over and sits down. I'm like, Katie, you're not the one that gave him the Korean passport. So we get like a 48-hour pass to go into Canada. And she gave a whale of a talk. And you guys would have been proud of her. But it took us over 4 hours to get back. And then, 4 hours in a passport, no breakfast, no lunch, no nothing. And we're sitting there. And of course, we miss all the flights, and we get to Seattle Airport, and I go, well, I don't want to be way off in Seattle. Can you get us anywhere? My best thinking as a sober member of Alcoholics is partway like Vegas, That ought to be restful, And so we get to Vegas at 8 p.m., we stay up till 3, and the next morning, I am so tired on the airplane. It reminded me of this buddy of mine in Bakersfield. It's a great story. This buddy of mine in Bakersfield flew from London to JFK and from JFK to LAX. And he said he fell asleep when they left the ground in JFK, and he didn't wake up till the wheels hit the ground in LAX. And he said, this is the way I was on the plane. He said he woke up and he looked at the guy next to him and he goes, wow, I was asleep. He says, I hope I wasn't snoring. And the guy goes, snoring, sir, was the least disgusting thing you did. So he said, I guess you don't want my card. Well, I'm glad to be here tonight. That's about as fast a version as I can give of that story in Canada. But I'm telling you, it was intense. So, coming to Arkansas was a real pleasure. That was that little flight from Dallas and then over here was just great. Let's get into my age story. What I hope we get the chance to talk about tonight is what I was like, what happened, and what it's like now. I hope to describe a love affair with the program of Alcoholics Anonymous that started back in the 80s. But, you know, before we go any further, in the program of Alcoholics Anonymous, it says that we, you know, if a story, for the story to interest and hold an alcoholic, it has to have depth and weight. So it's got to be my story, and it's got to have some experience. It reminds me of the guy that was driving along, and he sees a sign by this farmhouse, and it says, "Talking dog for sale." He goes up to the door, and he says, "You got a talking dog? You still got it?" And he says, "Yeah, he's around back." He goes around back, and there's this hound dog laying there, and he says, "So you can talk?" The guy says, "I certainly can." And he goes, "How did that happen?" He goes, "Well, when I was young, when I was a pup, I started picking up some of the language. And as I got a little older, I developed some nuances of the language. And so it's really led to an amazing career." He said, I was involved with the Drug Enforcement Administration for 26 years. I was able to infiltrate sites that nobody would have been able to get into. I've been involved in some of the largest drug busts in world history. And besides that, I've eaten in some of the finest restaurants in the world. I've traveled all over. I've stayed in 4-star hotels. And even more interesting, some of my pups have become international diplomats." And the guy says, "My God, it's been a real pleasure talking to you." And he goes around front and he says, "How much do you want for a dog like that?" And the guy says, "I don't know, $20. He goes, "Why would you sell a fabulous dog like that for $20? And the guy goes, "None of that crap he told you is true." So around here, it doesn't matter how good the story is if it's not my experience. You know, I come from a pretty normal family. I grew up in Dallas, Texas, and my mother was a first grade school teacher for 42 years. So I was pretty well prepared for the first grade. And did anybody else grow up under the burden of potential? I was told my whole life about my potential. You know, why can't you live up to your potential? Why can't you be more like Charles Mollier across the street? Why can't you this and that? And I remember thinking, I'm really not holding back that much. You know, I mean, it's a flattering comment, but I'm kind of giving you my best shot, Mom, you know. But I come from a fairly normal family in that there was no drinking in my family. I found out later there was alcoholism on both sides of my family. In fact, I didn't find out about a maternal uncle until I was 20 years sober, that there was this uncle that they wouldn't let come over to the house. I couldn't believe it. I'd never heard about it. But for me, I was pretty okay, you know, a lot of the stuff. But I felt that feeling of separation early on, starting in elementary school probably, that what I've described many times as a black hole inside of me that made me feel less than everybody, made me feel separate from everybody, a little bit apart from. You couldn't always tell it, but I had to outperform everybody in order to feel somewhat equal. If we were going to play baseball, I had to bat number 4, I had to pitch, you know, because of that feeling of separation that I had for a long time. I started drinking when I was 16 years old. You know, it's funny. I used to think that was young to start drinking. Now it's not even young to stop. You know, I mean, you know, much love for the young people in AA. I'm not knocking anybody, but I mean, my God, sometimes you see a guy come in and you know, you're like, you know, it's shocking. And one of my best friends in Austin, PJ, sobered up when he was 14. He's 41 now. He's got 27 years of sobriety. And if you listen to him tell his story, he didn't come in any too early. You know, I mean, he just barely got here. You know, so much love and respect to the young people. But for me, I started drinking at 16. And, it was the first thing I'd ever found that filled that hole, that made me feel okay. And I remember thinking, we are going to do this a lot. You know, I mean, this is something special here. I mean, Myers, a friend of mine, likes to say, you know, we all remember when we took our first drink. He goes, you know, how many of you remember the first time you ate green beans? You know, it's like, it's something special happened when I took that drink of alcohol. And, you know, it would be really macho to stand up here and say that I drank a half a gallon of vodka every day from the time I was 16 till I rolled into Alcoholics Anonymous, but that wouldn't be true. But what I can tell you is the absolute truth from my own experience is that there was never one time in that time that I turned down the opportunity to get loaded under any circumstances for any reason. Now, that's not everybody's story in Alcoholics Anonymous. There were people that held it together a lot better than I did, but for me, I was all about getting loaded. There are very few lines in this book that I don't identify with, but one of them is the line that says, our stories are filled with countless vain attempts to prove that we could drink like normal men. I have almost no experience with that. I never really tried to drink like normal men. But it started getting sloppy for me. I started drinking at 16. By 17 or 18, I had crossed that invisible line. So I had about 1 year of really good controlled drinking, you know. But somewhere around 17 or 18, as I started getting more and more access to it, it just really, it got really ugly and it got really sloppy really fast. I relate sometimes to the guys, and there's a hugely popular rock band. I don't want to break their anonymity, but several of the members of this band are in recovery, and they said that they knew they were in trouble when the guys from Motley Crue told them, you guys really need to slow down a little bit, you know what I mean? It's like, when you got this heavy metal death band saying, you guys are crazy, you know. Well, for me, the shortest version of my drinking is that, and I also have deep respect for the program of Alcoholics Anonymous and for the principle of singleness of purpose. I don't intend to get up here and talk about outside issues. I believe that AA is alcoholics working with alcoholics, and that and we don't do that to exclude the filthy dope fiends. We do it, you know. It's not like that at all. It's that identification. On page 18 in our book, it says, but one of our members who has found this solution, who's properly armed with the facts about himself, can win the confidence of a new man in a matter of hours. It says, until such an identification takes place, little or nothing can be accomplished. That means that bond that I feel when I get around another alcoholic is so important that out of all the 12-step programs that are out there, the only difference between, I think there's 300 12-step programs out there. I mean, there's a bunch. And the only difference is the first half of the first step and the middle part of the 12-step, what we're powerless over and who we carry the message to. Because gamblers work best with gamblers and alcoholics work best with alcoholics. Crackheads work best with crackheads. And, you know, I mean, and anybody that thinks it's all the same disease needs to see when a pure alcoholic tries to sponsor a crackhead sometime. I mean, he's out over his head the moment he steps out of the car. You know, so that's my little pitch on singleness of purpose. But I don't think it's all one disease, and I think it's critical that a guy find a fellowship that he identifies in. Because it says until that identification can take place, very little or nothing can be accomplished. Well, but having said that, I always drank, but I never just drank. I have a lot of experience in both areas. And the shortest version of my drinking story, because I've never sat down from a talk and went, doggone it, Katie, I didn't talk long enough about my drinking. You know, the guys that I drank with thought that I did too many outside issues. And the guys that I did outside issues with were shocked by my drinking, you know. So everybody that I knew thought Charlie Parker was getting a little bit too loaded, you know. So that's what I'm talking about. But, you know, it talks about losing the power of choice and control. You know, I only suffer from alcoholism under two circumstances. One is when I'm drinking it, and the other is when I'm not drinking it. You know, that's the way our book describes it so beautifully in the doctor's opinion. And it's that, you know, when I drink it, I suffer from an allergic reaction called the phenomenon of craving. When I can't promise you how much I'm going to drink or when I'm going to stop. My real problem starts when I try to not drink it. All my problems don't go away when I'm not drinking alcohol. When I get restless, irritable, discontent, the mental obsession returns. I drink again, and I get stuck eventually in this cycle where I'm going to drink until I have to stop, and then I will stop until I have to drink. That's the hopeless condition of mind and body that we talk about being delivered from. And that is that was big news when our program hit the ground. And it was big news in my life when I heard about it, because I could not start again. I always started getting loaded again. Well, when we talk about the loss of choice, you know, we all had stuff that happened. But one night in my drinking, I was leaving a bar, and I was in a collision. And I was a blackout drinker. Not everybody in AA was a blackout drinker. I was. I blacked out all the time. And, in fact, I thought that was just kind of the goal, you know, was oblivion. But I left a bar in a blackout one night, and I had drank 5 Long Island teas, and bam! And I remember seeing the fender over in the periphery of my vision, but we're still rolling. And I rolled the car, kept my foot on the gas, and I went around the corner, grabbed my shoes, and I'm running back to the bar to report the car stolen. And this is just a day in the life of Charlie Parker. And as I'm running back to the bar, there was 2 policemen out in the street. I'm running under this line of trees, and there's 2 cops out in the street with the flashlight, and there's glass all over the street. And I remember, in my drunken stupor, I remember thinking, my God, they got here really fast, you know? And so I ran to the bar, and I called, the next morning they called me, and they said, you're going to have to take a polygraph to pick up your car. And I said, well, why is that? They said, well, it was involved in an accident before it was reported stolen. I said, you're kidding. And he said, no, they ran into a parked police car. And I remember thinking, that explains how they got there so fast. Because I've been a little foggy on that one, yeah. But Norm Alpe used to talk about seconds and inches. If those 2 cops had been standing there when I rolled down that street, I could easily still be in jail. So my life could have gone a lot worse than it did. When I talk about the loss of choice and control, I like to talk a little bit about the pawn shops. I loved pawn shops. I don't know if anybody else, any pawners here, but I loved the entire equation because it was so pure. You know, you just walk in there with your thing and you give it to them and they give you the money and you leave. I don't ever remember a pawnbroker going, good God, man. Weren't you just here this morning? You know, or what are you going to do with that money? You know, or anything like that. Is just give them the shotgun and go. Well, the problem with this plan was I didn't own very much stuff. So so I had to pawn stuff that didn't belong to me. And that creates hard feelings in your circle of friends. So, but like all of my plans, you know, we make some good plans as drunks. And they all work really well until they stop working. And my plan was always you pawn the stuff, and then sometime in a 90-day period, you go get everything out of the pawn shop, and then you could roll. And, well, one time I'd pulled a scam that raised enough money to get everything out of the pawn shop. And I came out of a 5-day blackout, and 5 days, don't remember anything. And I was sitting on the side of the bed at my mother's house. I should also say that I was so poorly treated as a child that I left home for good at the age of 27. And I mean it. Never went back. And I had some apartments and stuff, but I mean, I would always go back to my mother's house. And I wake up on the edge of her bed, and I had $8 in my pocket. And I still had all those pawn tickets. And we've all had those mornings, you know, where you just go, oh, no. because I'd shot my wad getting the pulling that last little scam, and I'd blown the money, and I got nothing, and I still got all this. And this is, my dad was a good man, and if there are Al-Anons in the room, I'm glad you're here tonight. Any non-alcoholics in the room, I'm glad you're here tonight. I have to tell this story like it was a joke, because I still never know if I'm going to get through it or not. But I would have to go to my father and say, Dad, if we act now, I can get you a pretty good deal on all your stuff. You know, but if we wait till tomorrow, it's strictly retail. You know, so. And the point of that story is, when we're talking about the loss of choice and control, the point of that story is, we would get in his car and we would drive around. This was in Dallas, and Dallas is a big town, and it wasn't just going to the pawn shop. It was, we're going to go over here on Buckner Boulevard and pick up your shotgun, and I left your deer rifle on East Grand, and then your coin collection's up on Beltline Avenue, and the metal detector's in Oak Cliff, and we need to go to Garland and pick up, you know, this, and the sterling silver, and, you know, and it was all day in the car with me and my dad and all that shame. And, as we're driving along, I would say, Dad, I swear to God, I will never do this again. If I was lying to that man, I didn't know it, because I meant it with every fiber of my being. I knew that was bad. I knew that he was a good man, and nobody was giving him his stuff, and I'm out there pawning it. And I meant, I will never do this again. And within 24, 48, 72 hours, I would hit the back door of his house like a cat burglar. And you just go in there and go, that. And I'd grab a shotgun, or I'd grab a deer rifle, and off again. So, you know, my father and I made the rounds of the pawn shops 3 times before I finally sobered up in this program. So that's how slick I was when I got here. That's how cool I was when I got here. You know, I mean, and that's how well it was working for me, was that, you know, on my best power. What I did not know is that in the absence of the psychic change provided by this program, I did not have the power to make good on that promise that I was making to that man. I might as well have promised him that I was going to fly out the window and circle the pasture and fly back in through the front door. Because when I said I will never do this again, I did not have the power to not do it again. Our book says lack of power was our dilemma. Knowing that I was alcoholic didn't do anything for me. I walked around saying I'm alcoholic for a long time before I sobered up. In fact, it wasn't even this stuff that brought me into AA. What brought me into AA, and I didn't see it for a long time in the book, is back on page 152 in the big book, where it talks about the jumping off place, where it says he can't imagine life without alcohol. It says one day he'll be unable to imagine life with or without alcohol. Then he will know loneliness such as few men do. He will wish for the end. He'll be at the jumping off place. That's the place that drove me to Alcoholics Anonymous, was when I finally got to that place that I knew I couldn't keep going the way I was going, but I couldn't imagine not getting loaded at all. You know, I mean, if you're talking about nothing, it was horrifying. It was horrifying because, you know, I'd been willing to go in any direction for 12 years at that point. Well, I came into AA. I went to a treatment center that I'd heard about, and I had 3 slips after I sobered up. But I only went to treatment that one time. I met Jim in the treatment center, and I asked him to be my temporary sponsor, and he was my temporary sponsor for 16, 17 years, I think. You know, I have to be careful how I say this, because Jim was 100% in the deal. I mean, and he was giving me more than I'm giving any of the guys that I sponsor. I mean, as far as his time and his attention, and we were meeting at the noon meetings, and we were going to the cafeteria after, and we were traveling together, and we have some beautiful stories together. And we worked the steps. I mean, we went through the steps. But now, it's funny, because I went through one time, I have some friends in this program that like to say they never heard the message for 6 or 8 years, you know, that they were in the program. I don't know if that was the case for them. I know it wasn't the case for me. In fact, one time I think I said I didn't hear about a lot of this stuff till I'd been around for a while. And Jim pointed out to me that, is it possible that you were so resistant and defiant that no matter what the message was put in front of you, that you, not only would you not have heard it, but you'd have made fun of the person that was saying it. But for some reason, but having said that, we gave it a hell of a shot, you know, and we went through the steps. We did all the steps. Now, it was a little weak in 6 and 7 and in 11, but we did a fourth step. We did a fifth step. We were into the book. We were doing Tuesday night big book study. I think I did the Joe and Charlie big book studies 3 times. I love those guys. You know, I mean, that's some of the guys I was talking about in Arkansas. Some of my lineage, you know, goes right back to Joe. But I missed a lot. I missed a lot in the book. And my current sponsor likes to say, "How do you know what you don't know?" You know, I went through a period where, you know, I guess the story that I like to tell when I get a chance to get up here and talk is a story of untreated alcoholism in the rooms of Alcoholics Anonymous, because I think it's a message that has some grip, and I think that I'm not the only one that experienced a lot of what I'm going to describe. But if I am, and if a lot of the stuff I say is old hat and ridiculously simple to you, God bless you. But I'm going to tell you what my experience was in AA. There's a thing on page 30 that says we have to fully concede to our innermost selves that we're alcoholic. It's the first step in recovery. I knew that I had alcohol problems, but I don't think I fully understood the phenomenon of craving coupled with the mental obsession. And I'm not going to say that people weren't talking about it. I'll never forget, I was sitting with a guy one time, and he goes, "Man, I just wish there was somebody coming out of the book like this, you know, 17 years ago when I first sobered up." And I said, "Brother, not only were they probably saying it and you weren't listening to them, you probably made fun of them." And his eyes went real distant, and I went, "Come on." He goes, "There was a guy." I said, "Come, let's hear it." He goes, "Big Book Doug, we called him. You know, we all made fun of him. He always, big book, big book, big book, big book, big book, every meeting, you know." And he goes, "We all made fun of him." And I said, "So there it is, man. I mean, not the message was there, but you got to figure out now how to be more effective than Doug was. You know, how can we try, if we're going to grow in understanding and effectiveness, how can I get this message across?" Well, let me tell you what happened to me. I went through with an understanding. I worked a program that was based on abstinence from alcohol. Going back through the book takes a right turn at page 60. That if you're not careful, if I'm not careful, I missed it. If we go right from the second step, because easily I understood that I was powerless over alcohol and that my life was unmanageable. And are you willing to believe? I had a little struggle with that, but okay, I'm willing to believe. And if I go right from that to the third step, prayer, I miss that whole body of work that takes place on pages 60, 61, 62, and 63. The book says, we were now at step 3. The first requirement, I'll never forget going back through the book, and it says, the first requirement is that we be convinced that any life run on self-will can hardly be a success. What? You know, I mean, I remember on this pass through the book, you know, saying, not only was I not convinced that my life run on self-will could hardly be a success, that sentence never touched me, you know? And let me describe how it went for me. Because when I'm a guy that's living a program based on abstinence from alcohol, I'm totally in self-will. I don't understand what the book, and it's funny because I think the book knows on page 60 when it says the first requirement is that I be convinced that any life run on self-will can hardly be a success. I think it knows that at that point I don't have the information to be convinced that any life run on self-will can hardly be a success. That's why it says we're now at step 3 twice in the book. It says we're going to turn our will and our life over to the care of God as we understand. And then it's, the book has promised me clear-cut directions. It says, just what do we mean by that, and just what do we do? And it spends the next two pages telling me what they mean, and then it talks about what they do. And I got with some guys that were heavy in the book, and I thought I'd been in the book the whole time, but I remember one time I'm sitting there reading it, and Katie was sitting there, and I go, Katie, you know, self is all over this thing. And she goes, you really never saw that? And I'm like, mm-mm. She goes, that's some pretty basic stuff, Charlie. And I was like, missed it, you know. I mean, because I don't know about any of you guys, but that actor trying to run the whole show meant nothing to me. I mean, I used to read that and go, whatever. You know, I mean, you know, an actor running the show. And then, well, what happened was, I lived this program like it was based on abstinence from alcohol. And you all know that guy. You've heard him in the rooms where he's like, well, screamed at my wife on the way out the door this morning, and slapped a couple of the kids, and kicked the dog, and then went to work, you know, 30 minutes late, and looked at 2 hours of internet porn while I was at work, and then left work an hour early, and gambled on the way home, but that's okay, because I didn't drink today, and that makes me a winner. You know, it's like, no, that kind of makes you a jerk, you know, I mean. But my alcoholism leaks out in a lot of other areas. The book doesn't mention a spiritual malady until we get into the third step. And, you know, and in step three, it talks about, to me, the spiritual malady is what drives that mental obsession. It's what drives this level of discomfort that I carry around all the time. And it's what pushes, you know, and if I'm a guy like me, I am resourceful, you know, so if I'm not drinking alcohol, it's liable to squirt out in nine different areas. It's internet gambling, it's, well, you know, you should hear my diet talk sometime, you know, but I mean, but I'm down to one trick right now, you know, so, you know, it's a lot of stuff. It's spending money, it's, it can be sex, it can be a lot of stuff, but Cliff in Dallas likes to say that anything that treats the spiritual malady creates another 12-step program. You know, I mean, it's like anything that will fill that black hole for me is liable to get me in. You know, they've got a 12-step program out there for it. Well, what happens is, in a deal like that, I'm running completely on self-will in sobriety. And when I start running on self-will and sobriety, because even the reason I, you know, the thing I battle with today is this, there's this thing between God's will and self-will, and God's will and self-will. And what happens when I start running on self-will is God's will starts to drop down and Charlie's will drops up, and before I know it, it's all Charlie's will. God's will is not even part of the equation. You know, when people would say, well, where's God in all this? You're like, shut up. You know, because, you know, don't give me that AA crap. I got a real problem here, you know. I mean, you know, and this is serious, you know. And I don't even know it, you know. I'm running entirely on self-will. And what that looks like for me is I'll go, because there's a huge difference between having a faith in God and having a trust in God and having a consciousness of God, where God is actually part of my decision-making process. You know, I mean, because when I got a faith in God, but I kind of go, oh, yeah, sure, man. I mean, God is awesome. I mean, God is cool. I mean, I believe in God. I mean, God took away my drinking problem, and I'm just so grateful. I mean, now, I mean, and if I ever get a really big problem, I'll call him. I mean, but I don't need God for this. You know, I mean, I don't need God for this money thing. You know, I don't need God for this relationship thing or for this honesty thing. And, you know, and so a lot of this stuff can just become more self-knowledge for me. Well, what happened when I was living a life like that, I was getting knocked to the mat every time I stepped in the ring. The book says that I'm in constant collision with everybody when I'm running on self-will. I didn't know that. You know, I'm sober. I think I'm doing the deal. I'm going to the meetings. I'm living what I call meeting-based sobriety, where I go to the meeting And quick, somebody say what I need to hear, you know, and I get enough relief from that meeting to get me through the evening, and then I go back to living a life completely based on self-will the next day. And then by 5:30 tomorrow, I really need a meeting, you know, and then I come to the meeting again, and I get that relief, but I never get the freedom that this book promises me. When you talk about constant collision with something or somebody, I experienced the bedevilments on page 52, well into sobriety. You know where it talks about we couldn't control our emotional natures, we couldn't make a living, we were, you know, didn't seem to feel any real use to anyone. Well, that I was experiencing a lot of that in sobriety. And like I had a couple of divorces in sobriety, and looking back on it, you know, it's funny, I mean, at the time, if you'd have said, why did you get a divorce? I would have said, well, you know, she cheated on me and, you know, and it was really ugly and this and that. Looking back on it from where I'm standing today, I would say the level of self-centeredness that I was centering my life around drove the people that I cared about away from me. That's a long way from where I was at, you know, in 88 when I was getting that divorce. I didn't know that I, you know, how do you know what you don't know? I really thought that I was doing the deal. Well, when I got that second divorce, I was really damaged, and I made a terrible decision. I didn't really know it. I was still in an AA, but rather than crater to self-will and go, my God, me running the show myself is killing me, I actually thought I was doing AA, and I turned the wrong way. I turned a little more into self-will. There was a part of me that thought, by God, I've been doing it your way, and I'm getting knocked to the mat every time. I'm going to get me mine, you know, rigorous honesty, my butt. I'm, you know, and I started living even more on self-will. I hit a bottom at 4.5 years sobriety, didn't see it. I hit a bottom at 7 years of sobriety, and then for several years I had what I call my flat period in AA. I was still going to AA meetings. I was still doing the 10th step if I really messed up, but I could rationalize a lot. You know, I mean, a lot of times if I was angry, it was your fault. You know, I mean, and you had, but, well, what happened was I was rocking along, and I was in a plane crash in 2003. I was in a fairly dishonest relationship, but I mean, from the outside, it looked pretty good, and we had chartered a plane to fly from East Hampton out on Eastern Long Island into Manhattan, and the engine quit, and we crashed into the water at night. I don't have time for this whole story, but it was pretty dramatic. I mean, crashed into the water at night, five adults, one dog, everybody but the dog survived, but just barely. And I mean, I remember they said, you're cleared for landing at Gabreski, and I hear this first time in my life I've chartered a plane. You know, I mean, I knew couples that flew to the Hamptons every weekend, and the first time I hear the guy go, you don't understand, we've lost engine power, we can't make land, I'm going to have to ditch. And I was like, what? And he goes, prepare for impact. And we're like, excuse me, how do you do that? You know, and we hit the water, it's like splashdown times 1,000, you know, spray, the cowling comes off the, and the windshield blasts in. Now, let me tell you, then it went to complete silence. You're going, whoa, I think we're okay. This wasn't much of an airplane, but it was a really crappy boat. I mean, because right about the time we're thinking, hey, you know, I feel something right here on my knee, and it goes up like that, and I go up to get a lung full of air, and there's nothing but water in the roof of the plane. And I remember thinking, so that's it. I die in this airplane. And the doors wouldn't open, and then finally the doors came open, and we got out, and we drug everybody out. Well, I didn't know it, but it was the end of that marriage, but it was also the beginning of a spiritual experience, because it changed a lot of the things in my life. This was in July of 2003. I remember coming home from that, and I called up. I started getting some awareness of how self-centered I was. Some of you guys, I'm still making amends to Katie for it. Katie and I were litter mates when we came in, and we were literally best friends, like brother and sister for 20 years. She was married the whole time. We were all doing our AA thing. Zero flirtation, zero innuendo. I mean, we were like brother and sister for 20 years. And then her husband passed away about 6 years ago, and I like to say she caught me in a weak moment. And but we've been a couple for about 5 years, and I've never been happier in my life. But she can attest to my self-centeredness. And now, the thing I can tell you, when you start working with self-centeredness in the big book, and I didn't even realize it said it in the 12 and 12, because I don't spend a lot of time in the 12 and 12, but when you start working with self, the first place it becomes obvious is in others. You know, I mean, I can see self-centeredness in Bob. I can see self-centeredness, you know, in my sponsees, but I'm blind to it in myself. You know, that's why I got a sponsor, is because I don't see it. And one time, a story I wish I had time to tell, but I told this story at the treatment center about Katie's son and how, you know, if you want to see self-centeredness, check out a 16-year-old boy sometime. But I was telling this story, and she's a little defensive of Sam, and I love Sam, but, you know, I told this story about Sam, and she goes, well, it's funny you decided to tell that story about Sam out there. You didn't feel like telling him the story about the red pickup truck? No, I didn't, you know, and she reminded me of this time when her husband was going in. He had a brain tumor the size of your fist, and he was going in for surgery the next day, and I had a new pickup truck, and I insisted that Katie come down from the fifth floor and look at my new pickup truck. That's the level of self-centeredness that I'm capable of carrying around in sobriety, you know, so, but I didn't see it, and, I called up John Henry. I said, John Henry, I'm so self-centered, man. I can't even be involved in a conversation. I have to just force myself to go, how are the kids? You know, and act like I give a flip about the answer, you know. I mean, you know, because I want to talk about me, you know. And, I just find me fascinating. And he says, why don't you come to the office tomorrow? We'll go down and talk to the winos. And I remember thinking, no, that doesn't sound good, you know. Because you know how new guys are. They want to talk about themselves, and I want to be talking about me. But, you know, I met him down there, and we started going down there, and I started doing work at Austin Recovery Center. And I got to tell you, I was 17 years sober, 16, 17. I had my most significant spiritual awakening at 17 years of sobriety. I started doing the work with these guys, and they started asking me to sponsor them, and there were times where I felt like I was literally a step ahead of some of these guys. When you stay out of spiritual literature long enough, it goes away. I mean, it's like I'm reading this stuff for the first time. And there were times when I would say, okay, why don't you read the doctor's opinion and more about alcoholism tonight, and I'll come over here tomorrow. And I'd go home and I'd read the doctor's opinion and I'd read more about alcoholism. And we started hanging out with a bunch of big book thumpers, and we started, you know, listening to CDs and getting around people that were into the work. And I started sponsoring these guys, and I got back into the work. And Bob mentioned it today in the big book experience. I experienced a second surrender in sobriety. Well into sobriety, I had to surrender to self. The first surrender was to alcohol. And that was pretty easy because it came on the heels of an ass whooping. You know, I mean, it's pretty easy to surrender to alcohol when it's beat you to death. But I had to surrender to self. And I really became convinced that my life run on self-will could hardly be a success. There was a line in the book that leaped off the page at me one time. Anybody have that happen where they just sneak lines in your big book? This one came up and it said, is he not operating under the delusion that he can wrest satisfaction and happiness from this world if he only manages well? I was managing my ass off and losing my mind, you know. I started really trying to do this deal at a different level. And I had a new look at the book. I started working a lot with this thing we call the set-aside prayer. My sponsor uses it a lot, and it's basically something to the extent of saying, God, help me set aside everything I think I know about this book, about these steps, about the program. Even you, God, help me be available for a new experience. Help me see the truth. Something like that. And what happens is when I do that, because I like to read things that I agree with. And you know, and if I don't do the set-aside prayer, I'll read this book and I go, uh-huh, oh yeah, oh yeah, mm-hmm, oh yeah, got that one underlined and highlighted. You know, And no new information is getting through because what I think I know stands in the way of the truth, you know. And doing the set-aside prayer, I started having some new experiences in this book. And, you know, when we got into the... It's funny, I look at it like the Cowboys game, because the thing I like to talk about when I get a chance to talk is that I think there's plenty of message of the hope of recovery for the new guy in AA. For the new man coming into AA, I think there's plenty of message that this deal works. And if you do what we do, you can get what we got. But the guy I like to talk to is the guy that's been in the rooms for a while. 2 years, 4 years, 7 years, 17 years. I'm telling you that the experience is still... That experience is still available, and it's available as a result of the work out of this book. I didn't know I was missing it. I almost missed it. If I had died in that plane crash, I would have thought that I knew what AA had to offer for me. If you'd have come to me when I had 17 years and I was so miserable and said, Charlie, what is going to change your life and what is going to set you on fire is the program of Alcoholics Anonymous, I would have told you you're crazy, because I've done AA. I know what that brings me. I've been sitting in these rooms for 17 years, man. I was always going to the meetings, but I just didn't know what I was missing, you know. And I look at it like one time, last year I had a sponsee. I love the Dallas Cowboys. I've loved the Cowboys since they were good. I just knocked off the microphone there, but, you know, I've been to a lot of Cowboy games. Jim and I have been to a ton of Cowboy games. They used to have training camp where he worked, and we used to go eat lunch with the Cowboys. I mean, and after last year, I was responding, he says, you know, my family's got a skybox. And I went, what? In September, he called me. He goes, you want to go see the Eagles game? And I went, absolutely. And we went. We get in a separate entrance. We go up a little private escalator. They got a civilized little hallway you walk down. There's waiters and waitresses. They're bringing you ice. And I'm going, I mean, I didn't know whether to be happy about being there or pissed off about all the years I'd had to sit in the cheap seats. You know, because it turns out there's this whole level of the deal that I didn't even know was there. You know, when I started talking, and that's the way I feel about AA. I was looking at the wrong thing. When I was living that life based on that program based on abstinence from alcohol, it reminded me, Chuck C. used to tell a story about a guy. I didn't know what I was really dealing with. Chuck C. used to tell a story about a guy that was afraid of dogs. And he'd always been afraid of dogs. And he did a little inventory, and he said that he realized that one day, when he was a kid, one of the neighborhood dogs had bit him. Well, as he got to inventorying it further, he remembered that he'd been chasing one of the neighborhood girls across her yard when her dog came out and bit him. And he said all his life he'd been running from dogs and chasing women, and dogs never were his problem, you know? I mean, that's the way I was when I was looking at just trying to not drink. My problem, it says the root of our selfishness, self-centeredness, that we think is the root of our problem. It says above everything, we have to be rid of the selfishness. My sponsor goes, what does above everything mean to you? You know, I mean, it's fairly important. But if I go right from are you willing to believe to getting down on my knees and doing the third step prayer, I miss that whole body of work. I spend about an hour and a half going over the actor because I didn't understand that he's not the director. He's just an actor that's running around acting like an idiot. And then it started making sense. And then I started seeing how the toolkit of self-will, where I'll try to be nice or I'll try to be overbearing, but it's all about me getting my way. And then, you know, and that doesn't work. I start to think I'm not, well, it describes Charlie Parker perfectly there on those pages, but I didn't see it for a long time. So, you know, when I started going back through the book now, I understand a whole new deal in the third step. You know, that I'm going to quit playing God. And it says, established on such a footing, that God being all powerful, he'll give me what I need under two conditions. If I stay close to him and perform his work well. That's the deal. The book says God doesn't make too hard of terms for those that seek him. Those are the terms.
The terms of the deal are I stay close to God, perform His work well, and He'll give me what I need. It's funny, I was talking to a sponsee the other day, and I said, you know, because I've been employed, self-employed my whole life, and I said, all I can tell you is that when I was all out for me, and I was working all the time, and I was doing some of that dishonesty I talked about was showing up in the office. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail, but I'm in a construction business. The whole time I was working all the time, I was chasing my tail, and I was in trouble, and I was overdrawn the whole time. And then when I started doing this deal on the square, and all of a sudden I'm spending half of my time working with new guys. It seems like I spend at least half of my time with AA stuff and working with new guys, and I'm flush for the first time in my life, and I've never been happier in my life. And he goes, don't you think that's just from being established in business now and stuff? And I was like, no, I don't think that. I thought that for a long time. I had been in business for 20 years. And when I was experiencing that, and now doing the deal with God's way, because I had some things in my life, some of that dishonesty that started showing up was, you know, God, you take everything, you know, well, except for those insurance certificates, and you know, and this little thing here, but you can have everything else, and it moved me away from the sunlight of the Spirit. I had no idea how much I was blocked. Well, when I went back through the work this time, I did a fourth step right out of the big book, and I had done it out of the big book before, but I was weak in the fourth column, and this time in the fourth column, you know, it's funny, because I did it with Myers in Dallas, and I remember, you know, he goes, I got to go make the coffee. He says, you just make a list of the people you're resentful at. I'll be right back. He came back. I had 27 names written down there, you know, and it's Sprint, and it's Ford, and it's American Airlines, and it's, he goes, my God, man, you're resentful about 5 million people collectively. And I'm like, he goes, how long since you did an inventory? And I said, 17 years. You know, when I was new, I heard somebody say, you only have to do one inventory. And I rode that train for 17 years. You know, I was like, I don't believe that now. I believe that a business that takes no regular inventory usually goes broke. And I'm a believer in regular inventory. And I like doing multiple fifth steps. I'm involved with a group of guys now that we will do inventory, and then I'll do multiple fifth steps. I might do a fifth step with Bob, and then I might do one with my sponsor, and then I might do one with one of the guys that I sponsor. It's something I had a lot of opinion about, but my sponsor said, I'm not interested in your opinion about an experience that you've never had. You know, if you've taken multiple fifth steps, then we'll talk about it. It's kind of like the thing about multiple inventories. You know who says don't do more than one inventory? The people that have only done one inventory. You know, I mean, I don't think we've ever had anybody come in and go, I did four inventories over the years. I really should have stopped at one. You know. Those last three were really dragging me down, you know. But how do you know what you don't know? Well, this time in the fourth column, I'm seeing selfish, dishonest, inconsiderate, afraid. Next written resentment, selfish, dishonest, resentful, afraid, inconsiderate. Next one, blam, 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 blam. Well, after about eight, I'm like, I'll do the fourth column. You know, I'm selfish because of this and this and that, and I was inconsiderate here because, you know, I didn't think about it, and I was dishonest because it was delusional of me to think. My sponsor said there's three forms of dishonesty. There's lying. There's lying by omission. And then there's delusion. Boy, when we started talking about delusion, I started nailing a lot of dishonesty because a lot of my dishonesty was thinking things were going to be different than they were when there was nothing to suggest that it would be. But now, because before, when I did six and seven, it was like, just kind of phone them in, you know. But this time, you know, they're just two little paragraphs about that big. This time I had real stuff to take into the six and seventh step. You know, when I did that hour, I was busy, and I was looking at the first five steps, and I had real stuff to take to God to say, God, please help me be more considerate, and help me be more honest, and help me be less selfish and less self-seeking and that stuff. And I really had real stuff that I was taking to God. And then it's God's business, you know. I can't remove that stuff. Even like the selfishness. You know, I used to wonder why they had selfishness in step three. If it's, you know, if it's the root of, why didn't they put it in the inventory, you know, because it's still trying to guide me to God. It's saying, you can't wish away that selfishness any more than you could alcohol. You know, I can't read 60 to 63 and go, by God, I've got to be less selfish. You know, I mean, it says God makes that possible. And there often seems no way of entirely getting rid of self without his help. Well, with his help, it's gotten a lot better. You know, I got to talk to you a little bit about the eighth step. I had a powerful experience. I have a group of guys that I sponsor. And on Thursday nights, we have a meeting we call the Common Solution. And we meet on Thursday nights at my house. And it's me and my sponsor and all the guys I sponsor. And one of the things that became obvious for a bunch of guys that had a little time in the program was, at our first meeting, Mark goes, how many people have unfinished amends? Well, I'm not going to ask for a show of hands here, but everybody at the table had unfinished amends. And he said, well, I think it's obvious that our work needs to start there, because how many times do people come to you and they go, I really like to do another inventory? And you're like, really? Have you done all the amends from the last one? No, that's kind of what's making me think I need to do another inventory. You know, it's like, finish the amends process before we talk about that. And we sat there, and let me tell you a powerful experience. If you've never tried it, get some of your brothers or sisters in sobriety, and everybody make a list of your unfinished eight-step amends. Because for me, I made the barn burners. I made the ones that were like the first things touched by that hurricane of my life. But I had a lot of stuff out there. Well, we sat down, and we made a list of our amends, and everybody read it. Everybody read their list of their unfinished amends. We start over here. Well, let me tell you something. If you sit in on something like that, keep your pencil handy. Because my eight-step list grew considerably listening to other people's lists. You know, I mean, because I'm sitting there, I'm thinking, oh, I got a pretty good list. Pretty good list. Yes, sir. Ready to go. Pretty good list. And then Jamie goes, well, I bought gas and drove away without paying. And I'm like, you know, and I ate in restaurants and left without paying. You're like, oh, okay, you know. And then I disrespected my mother, you know, and questioned her. I made her, you know, try to make her accept behavior that was against her values and stuff like that. Okay, you know. And I'm writing them down, and I'm writing them down. Well, when this consciousness of the amends process becomes, because the book says made a list of all persons we have harmed and make amends to them all. My experience has been, if I put it on a list, that list is liable to, it'll look kind of like this, and it'll wind up in a drawer somewhere. What we do is we take those amends, once we've got them, and we put them on amends cards that look like that. And I carry them in my wallet, you know, and they talk to me. And they're sitting on my desk, and it'll say, you know, my sister, my selfishness has kept me from being supportive of her. I let her bug me rather than praying for patience and tolerance. I've knocked her to mom and others. I've been judgmental of her and critical. And then down at the bottom it says, have I harmed you in any other way? Because when I go to make amends to somebody, if I'm living a life based completely on self, I have almost no idea of my effects on other people. You know, I mean, so I might go to her and go, I'd like to make amends for that. And at the end of it, she goes, that's how you think you've harmed me? You know, that's not even top 10, you know. I mean, sit down here, you know. And then, but I've been doing these amends, and I've been going through it. I mean, I had to send money into 7-Eleven for running out with cases of beer. And you know, I'm making amends to companies that aren't even in business anymore. But as I get into that consciousness, stuff starts bubbling to the surface. I mean, amends are coming up that I didn't even see. I mean, Katie and I were walking around in Crested Butte one day, and she thought I had a stomach cramp, you know, because we're walking along and went, oh. She goes, what? And I go, oh, I was riding my motorcycle past a golf course one time, and I went out and did a donut on the green around the flag, you know. I'm in the golf business. This course that I did it at is one of my customers now, you know. So now I got to call him up and go, how much would it cost to fix a green that somebody had done a donut on? And, you know, I asked my sponsor, I said, can I pay him back in $1972? And it's like, you know, do you have any $1972? You know, it's like, but we're doing this amends process now. And then in 10 and 11, the way Katie and I went to a big book experience, a big book weekend one time, and this guy was there, and he's talking about the disciplines of 10, 11, and 12, the strict disciplines of 10, 11, and 12. And I'm living in the disciplines of 10, 11, and 12, and the disciplines of 10, 11, and 12, and the strict disciplines of 10, and you're like, la, 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 la. You know, please shut up. You know, I mean, because I'm not touching the strict disciplines of 10, 11, and 12. And he stands up there and he goes, if you're not praying and meditating on a regular basis, you're not working the 12 steps of Alcoholics Anonymous. How's that 11-step program working out for you? You know, and at that Thursday night meeting, we follow this thing we call the path of consideration, where sometimes we'll offer consideration. Guys that we have spiritual consent with, we'll establish spiritual consent, and we'll say, Bob, you have spiritual consent with me. Anything you see me doing, I'm giving you the right to call me on, whether it hurts my feelings or not. And then, you know, if I keep reporting that I'm not doing the 10th and 11th step, one day I remember a particular consideration where we said, is it possible that the reason you're not doing the daily disciplines is because you don't think it's important and you think you can stay sober without it? Well, the other part of that is all I get to say in response to that is thank you. Because if I respond, you're going to get my ego coming back at you, defending itself, you know, saying, I've just been busy, for God's sake. You know, I mean, it's not that I don't think it's important. I mean, come on. Well, I mean, it's been a few months, but, you know, and so all I get to do is go, thank you, you know. And we kind of hold each other up like that. And I'm telling you, man, stuff that looked way over the top to me a few years ago is just part of our daily lives now. The life that Katie and I are living in recovery is unbelievable. I would have... The talks we have in the morning, we get, you know, and I'm drawn to people like Bob and Myers and Chris and Mark and all these big book thumpers out there, you know, and we get around and we talk about the stuff, and you know, when you're sponsoring guys, stuff comes up. I mean, the real magic in this program is in working with others, you know, as we're getting out there carrying the message, which never sounds like a good idea. Service work. Almost never, you know, just almost never sounds like a good idea. How'd you like to go over to the detox center on, you know, this week? Okay. You know, and we go over there. Well, I've started sponsoring these guys, and it has been the light of my life. I mean, some of the stories I could tell you about sponsorship, I never even would have thought, you know, some of it was possible. But, you know, it's funny, there was one guy, Jamie. I love to talk about Jamie. This guy, I mean... I'm going to try to get through this. I'm a biker. I'm done all this stuff. But, I mean, I'm also liable to cry like a little girl in a pink dress up here. But I'm sponsoring Dutch, and I go out to see Dutch, and then here comes this other guy, and he's walking at me, and I'm thinking, please, God, don't ask me to sponsor you. You know, I mean, because he's coming, you know, and he's got dreadlocks out to here, and he's got ink everywhere you can see, and he's got, you know, metal all in his face, and he's got a ring in his nose, and what's up, you know, and I start working with Jamie, and he is my best soldier. This guy is the most willing guy that I've got in my stable, and if I say, Jamie, you go over and tell that guy you're going to be a sponsor, you know, he's on it, you know, and one day I'll never forget, this is the kind of willingness that I like to see, it's the kind of willingness I try to keep in my life, you know, because I remember one day he came in, he was mad at his wife, I mean mad, and he's sitting at my desk and he goes, you know, and she was this and she did that, and he goes, and I am not apologizing to her, unless you tell me to, and then I will, but, you know, and, I mean, but there's a stable of guys, I bet Katie sponsors 20 girls, I'm sponsoring about 12 or 14 guys actively. These are all guys that are in the work and they're out there doing the deal. And, you know, when you have real solution to offer somebody, when a guy has had a psychic change, I don't think you've got to press him into service work. You know, when I've experienced that spiritual experience, you can't stop me from telling somebody about it. And the real magic is when you got real solution to give to that guy, you know, where he comes up and says, will you sponsor me? Can you put me through the work? I'm absolutely, man. I can show you exactly what I did right out of the book. That's why we call it the common solution, because we're given the same deal. And next thing you know, you look up and that guy's got his little newcomer and they got the book out between them. And then a couple of months later, Katie and I started a meeting called the Primary Purpose Group in Dallas 3 years ago. And we study the big book line by line, word by word, week after week. That's all we do is study the book. And you talk about creating the fellowship you crave. We were sick of open discussion meetings. I'm not saying that they're bad. but do we need 900 of them? You know, I mean, we wanted a meeting where we study the book and we talk about the solution. And we're starting to see a ripple effect through the community of people that are out there carrying the real message of Alcoholics Anonymous. It has been unbelievable, you know, watching these people get into the real deal and get out there and carry in the message. You know, I mean, the thing that I would say to you is get in there and really do the work. Try actually working all 12 steps of the program of Alcoholics Anonymous and see what happens. If you've been around the rooms for a while and you're not feeling what you hear people describing out there, get with somebody, find that annoying big book thumper in your group and say, can you put me through the work? And see what happens. You know, it comes with a money back guarantee, but you know, really getting in and doing all 12 steps of this program brought about an experience that I never knew was available in the program of Alcoholics Anonymous. Katie and I have been on fire. You know, I mean, we're actually not married. We're going to get married in the next 2 months. And we're very excited. Yeah. It's I meant to say that at this Big Book study meeting that we have on Tuesday nights, there's usually about 175 people in there on Tuesday night studying the Big Book. I think that the Fellowship of Alcoholics Anonymous is hungry for real solution. And if you put real solution in front of a real alcoholic, they're hungry for it. You know, and it's just been, it's been the light of my life, and I almost missed it. You know, getting to come to conferences like this, it's just a wonderful opportunity to get around people that are really doing the deal. But the thing that I always like to say is studying the book, going to big book study meetings, going to conferences, hearing the solution, I can get right up next to the solution, but if I don't actually do the work, it's still just more self-knowledge. I come into these conferences and I get inspired and then I go back to my life and I don't really. I'm talking about get with somebody and really do the deal and see what happens. Because the book tells us where self-knowledge is going to get me. I can drag my ego through the work studying the book. You know, I mean, where I'm just trying to have a ready response and a quick answer for a sponsee. But if I'm not experiencing this program from the ears up, is fatal. I got to have God consciousness. You know, there's a huge difference between a belief in God and actually walking around swimming in God consciousness, where God is a part of my life, part of my decision-making process, really trusting the deal and going with it. I've been so honored to be up here tonight. Hope it didn't sound like I was lecturing. I was really, we have so much fun in the program. You know, Katie has her girls over on Monday night. I have my guys over on Thursday night. She kept pressing women into sponsoring people. I believe in men sponsoring men and women sponsoring women. Come on. Anybody out there? Katie was pressing her girls. If you want to see her get torqued up, say, there was a friend of mine that was out there saying, there's not enough strong female sponsorship out there. Oh, Scrappy sprung into action there. But she's, you know, there's just not enough strong sponsorship out there, you know, male or female. So I really like seeing people get into the work and get into the doing the deal. She started doing these workshops at the house on Monday, once a month on Monday night, taking these women through the steps out of the book. And I came home Monday night, and there were 37 cars out in the street. I mean, I walk in the house, my living room, big hand for Katie. The big book is showing up in their sponsorship, and it's showing up in the work, and you're seeing people's lives change. And this program still works just the way Dr. Bob promised us it would. On page 100, it says, both you and the new man must walk day by day in the path of spiritual progress. If you persist, remarkable things will happen. When we look back, you know what? I read this at the end of talks for a long time, and I never saw where it says, we look back. When we look back, this is a looking back program. I can't tell you how many times it seems like when I'm in self-will that my will get me just a little bit better deal than God's going to give me. Has anybody else experienced that? You know? But it says when we look back, we see that the things which came to us when we put ourselves in God's hands were better than anything we could have planned. Follow the dictates of a higher power, and you will presently live in a new and wonderful world, no matter what your present circumstances. You guys are having a great conference here. Thank you for having me. Thanks.